Vamos então dar início à nossa sessão sobre o futuro dos clientes e dos consumidores. E vamos iniciar com uma conversa com o nosso analista responsável por essa área de research na Europa. Mas antes, deixa-me apresentar o nosso Futurescape sobre Future of Customer and Consumers. A IDC publicou há poucos meses as top 10 predictions para o relacionamento, para aquilo que é o futuro do relacionamento das organizações públicas e privadas com utentes, clientes e consumidores. E, portanto, relembro que o nosso Futurescape tem três variáveis. Uma é o eixo horizontal, onde indicamos o tempo em que acreditamos que cada uma dessas tendências vão se tornar mainstream. Depois temos o eixo vertical, que mostra aquilo que é a complexidade ou o custo para lidar com cada um desses temas. E depois temos, no fundo, o impacto que cada uma dessas previsões tem no mercado como um todo. Portanto, a primeira previsão é aquela que maior impacto tem no mercado, e assim sucessivamente. E, portanto, são essas as top 10 predictions. Nós temos visto aquilo que tem sido, digamos assim, o acelerar dessa estratégia digital first no relacionamento com os clientes. Temos visto aquilo que tem sido a preocupação das organizações em criarem uma maior empatia com os seus clientes, comunicarem cada vez mais, principalmente em relação a essas novas gerações, a geração Z, os alpha buyers, comunicarem mais com uma base de entretenimento. Temos visto um crescimento exponencial daquilo que é o vídeo, principalmente aquilo que está relacionado com aquilo que chamamos o consumer generated videos. Temos visto também aqui um novo contexto de negócio associado sobretudo também a parcerias desenvolvidas através de plataformas digitais, de forma a acelerar cada vez mais a inovação digital. Temos visto também tendências relacionadas com a capacidade hoje das organizações não só de desenvolverem as tais apps para criarem novas experiências ou melhores experiências com os seus clientes, mas sobretudo integrarem essas apps com os seus sistemas empresariais. E depois há alguns outros temas que hoje já são marcantes, mas vão se tornar cada vez mais no final do período de previsão. Um tem a ver com a questão relacionada com a privacidade, cada vez mais valorizada pelos consumidores, a questão da responsabilidade social e a questão da humanização da relação com o cliente, mesmo no canal digital. E, portanto, essas são as top 10 predictions, mas vamos olhar para elas de uma forma mais detalhada, e para isso eu vou passar para inglês e vamos conversar com o nosso analista, o Filippo Baitani. Good morning, Filippo. How are you?
Very well, Gabriel. How are you?
It's great to have you here in our Futurescape in Portugal. We are doing this event this year, digital, total digital. So it's great to have you here. I just shared our top 10 predictions that we published in our Futurescape about the future of customer and consumers. And it would be great to have your view and your opinion about these trends in Europe. And the first one is really something that we saw in the past, I would say, 3-2 years, but accelerate last year with the COVID-19 situation. So this digital first strategy, how do you see it in Europe? Can you share with us your opinion about this?
Sure, Gabriel. This is a prediction for 2021, but of course, because we are already in 2021, is already happening. And in all fairness, it was already happening in 2020 with the most forward-looking retailers, the retailers that had the resources to invest in digital transformation in preparation for the pandemic. So when they were actually getting into the pandemic, which of course it was something that no one could predict it, these companies, they were already well equipped with the right tool to actually scale up those capabilities that responded very well to the changes in consumer demand. So the pandemic essentially changed dramatically the way consumer shops. There is much more interaction online. Contactless in store is growing dramatically. And these changes are here to stay. That's why we are thinking that this is a prediction for 2021, but it's something that will involve the retail industry in particular for the next few years to come. And companies need to rethink their business model and the way they actually operate and the way they actually implement business model digitalization. We have examples, as I was saying, in 2020 of companies that they were already scaling up capabilities. For instance, large retailers such as Sainsbury's in the UK or Carrefour in France, they were able to accelerate, for instance, capabilities such as click and collect, curbside pickup, and their e-commerce capabilities. We have even more forward-looking example of Walmart, for instance, in the US, that has started to fill online orders with robots on the back end of store operations. Or Amazon, with their technology related to Amazon Go stores, that is actually testing biometric palm scanning systems to allow shoppers to actually pay without even carrying a mobile phone, so just with their hands.
No, great. Yeah, it's a kind of predictions for today. So it's really happening. And there are other predictions that are related with this new generation, the alpha buyers and the G and the generation Z. And it's really changing the way we communicate with consumers, with clients, especially in these segments. And I think we have two predictions around this, and one is specific about this growing trends around video and especially consumer-generated video. Could you share with us your opinion and our vision about this trend?
Sure, Gabriel. Well, we see this as a very up-and-coming trend. Social media such as TikTok, with their very short videos, they're extremely popular among the younger segment of the consumer base. But more in general, digital technology has changed quite dramatically the way consumers communicate with brands and also the way consumers seek for recommendation on product to buy. So we see that consumer-generated video are really a more credible form of advertising and brand awareness tool for companies and particularly for retailers to use, because this tool can guarantee that you will have a genuine support, something that it's not perceived as bias, such as, for instance, if you have the same kind of endorsement but from celebrities, for instance. If it comes from a peer of the consumers, the consumer perceive it as more authentic. And we have several examples of how companies are actually engaging with social media, such as TikTok, to actually leverage this trend of consumer-generated video. For instance, in the UK, online fashion retailer Boohoo has been launching several campaigns in which they were basically referring to a hashtag to actually encourage consumers to actually share their video, using the hashtag to identify the video in which they were showcasing basically their outfit that that they had purchased on Boohoo, and showcase to other users how they actually look on their outfit. So this is a very powerful form of communication that resonates particularly well with the younger segment of the consumer base.
Oh yeah, it's really. I watch these trends in my home with my daughter. It's incredible how these new generations are really creating this new content. And it's interesting to see how companies are leveraging this in order to improve their business. So it's really, really interesting. But there is another prediction that came to my mind, and it's a kind of like the first one. So it's really happening now. I think it's the prediction number five, where we are saying that customers will spend 25% more with companies that are responding quickly and being agile and helping and adapting to this new context. 25% more. So can you share a little bit more about this with us, Filippo?
Yeah, this is really just the impact of what we were discussing with the first prediction. Those companies that they were already ahead in their digital transformation journey, they actually managed to better respond to the changes in consumer demands. So, for instance, in 2020, we saw a strong disruption of consumer demands, and many companies actually suffered from this disruption. But those companies that they managed to actually have the tool already in place and to leverage this tool with a scale-up of these capabilities, they managed to actually attract more of that customer demand that was actually simply shifting from one channel to another. So, namely, from the brick-and-mortar channel to the digital channel. So if you have those capabilities, then you manage to gather momentum and to actually leverage and to benefit from the increase in consumer demand. Going forward, we believe that those companies that they have already leveraged this opportunity, they will actually start from an advantageous point, let's say. So they will be able to increase even more their client base because their performance or the way they actually, the experience, let's say, that they deliver during the pandemic help them actually to gain new consumers. If you think about e-grocery, so shopping for groceries online, many shoppers, they started to buy grocery online during the pandemic. They are not going back to their old habits once everything is over. They will keep some of their shopping habits that they developed during the pandemic also when we are entering the next normal. So we will see that those companies that they were able to grow, for instance, their online channel, they will generate even greater business from this new consumer. And examples abound, for instance, I can give you a clear example that shows how different companies in the same verticals, they reacted differently. So if we think about fast fashion, so apparel, we have, for instance, Inditex, so the owner of Zara brand, that they fare much better in 2020 than H&M, for instance, because Inditex had already in place before entering the pandemic all the structures to leverage and to scale up their e-commerce capabilities. So despite they had loss altogether because they couldn't operate stores, the loss were partially mitigated by the rise in e-commerce that actually a close competitor of Inditex, H&M, didn't have the structure in place because it was relying much more on their physical presence. And it didn't manage actually to, they didn't have that trade-off, let's say, that compensates the loss in physical retail with the rise in digital retail.
Oh, yeah, it's really crazy how things are going very quickly in terms of putting pressure for creating new digital channels, so this new context, developing this digital first strategy, and we are seeing even more partnerships to address the opportunities and the challenges in the market, and we have a prediction here saying about these trends around creating partnerships in order to deliver a better service, to innovate faster. So we are putting this prediction in 3 years. So how do you see it evolving in Europe, Filippo?
So the thing is, Gabriel, that the shopping journey has become increasingly complex, and retailers or companies in general, they don't really have the capabilities in-house to actually respond to the complexity of the shopper journey. So the consumer journey is really, really complex now, and you need to acquire those capabilities externally. One, it's because you don't have the resources to develop those capabilities in-house. And second, because you need to roll out those capabilities quite rapidly. That's why we predict a surge in collaboration. We've already seen it in 2020, but we are predicting that going forward, there will be an even stronger rise in collaboration, in acquisitions, in retailers that they will buy companies that specialize in a certain kind of capabilities, but even in simple collaboration. So I can give you a few examples. I don't know, for instance, in the UK, many supermarkets like Sainsbury's, for instance, they join forces with Deliveroo or, those companies that they actually can help them to deliver groceries from the store to the consumers. So to solve that last mile challenge. And they did so because despite many of these companies, they had already capabilities in-house to deliver, by partnering up with the likes of Deliveroo, they managed to acquire a new segment of consumer base that they weren't actually shopping before on their portal, for instance, but they shop on the Deliveroo app. So this is a very smart strategy, actually, also to provide a capability, but also to expand your consumer base, because you're reaching out to a segment of the consumer base that it wasn't there before for you. Or, for instance, we saw a rise in retailers that are launching marketplaces. So, for instance, we have Carrefour and Cdiscount in France. And the reason is because by launching marketplaces, you are actually expanding your offering by partnering up with other suppliers, with other vendors, with other retailers that are going to sell on your platform. So, for instance, if we take Carrefour, they open the marketplace because in this way they can actually provide those, for instance, locally sourced products that from local companies that otherwise they had less visibility on their normal e-commerce channel. With this channel, with the marketplace channel, they can offer that new offering to their customers, and as such, they can expand their customer base.
Oh, interesting, interesting. Filippo, a last question regarding a topic that is transversal to every topic we talk about, digital transformation, and we have been talking it in the CEO digital strategy, in the future of work. We have been talking about this in innovation. We have been talking about this is about the purpose of the organization and how we can communicate it to our employees, to our partners, but especially for our customers and consumers in general. And we have here this prediction that is a kind of short-term one, saying that the social responsibility will be key. And as I understand, 80% of the corporations will develop or modify the social responsibility statement in the next 2 years. So it's a big change. Can you share a little bit more with us? How do you see this trend going forward?
Sure, we developed this trend with our global team, so there's a lot of input from our US team. If you can remember the Black Lives Matter movement in 2020 and how many companies they actually release statements of support for this particular social cause. But I think here what is important is also to stress the element of sustainability. Apart social responsibility, the closely connected themes of sustainability is something that we see very strongly for the future, and especially in verticals such as retail. And this is because consumer behavior has now been radically changed, and the way consumers are actually informing their shopping decision is based also for a large share on what the brand that they are buying represents. So what are their ethical credentials? What are their sustainability credentials? And as such, retailers and companies in general need actually to demonstrate that their operations are sustainable, the product that they sell is ethically sourced, and so on. So elements such as investment in supply chain visibility becomes really important. You have to guarantee that what you are selling has a certain provenance, for instance, or is sourced in a certain way. Marketing campaign to actually show that you stand for something and your message is environmentally friendly or respond to certain concern of the consumer base will become increasingly important because shoppers are actually looking at these elements to inform their shopping decision. We've seen some very recent examples. For instance, last year, Black Friday, of course, it was impacted by the pandemic, but in Europe, we had IKEA, for instance, launching a campaign about Turn Black Friday Green, which entailed instead of promoting sales, IKEA promoted things to do with furniture that you have already, that you possess, that you own already. So instead of encouraging people to buy new furniture, they were showing what can you do with the furniture that you already have. Or for instance, I don't know, recently H&M partnered up with Lee to launch sustainable denim because a lot of shoppers and consumers are concerned about how the producing process of jeans, of denim, has an impact on the environment. And that's why companies such as H&M are doing something about it by showing that their denim, the denim that they sell, is actually sustainable. And also, for instance, H&M, this was from a few years back, they already equipped their stores with a recycle bin where you can actually go there and dispose of the clothes that you bought a few months ago from H&M and you don't want anymore. And then you can rebuy new clothes. And many of these clothes are actually made of recycled material. So it's all going towards that direction.
Thank you, Filippo. Now, it was great to hear your comments about our predictions and how it's happening in Europe. And it's interesting to see how the COVID-19 accelerates the digital adoption and how the digital adoption is accelerating other trends like sustainability and this social responsibility, the humanization of the relationship with customer and consumers, the development of new partnerships. So it's really, really interesting. It was a great conversation. So thank you very much, Filippo. It was great to have you here with us in this Futurescape. Thank you.